So while looking for the feedback for the session, I think the host was asking whether you got it or not. So I always have a thumb rule. If everybody is not asking questions, then there are only two things could have happened. Either nothing was clear or everything was clear. So I hope you have a lot of questions after what I present. Let me introduce myself. My name is Sethu, and I lead the business for India and Middle East for KNOLSKAPE. Closer to about 5 years now with the organization, seen it grow from 12 to 125 employees as we speak across 4 countries and clients in about 25 countries. But this session has nothing to do with what we as a company do, but I thought it should be useful for you and made a presentation on leadership development for the modern employee. So though I love technology a lot, digital a lot, it's by choice I've decided to tone down the whole presentation into what's more useful for you. So I'm going to talk more about the impact that digital and technology is making around us in the formation of a modern employee and what it means for developing leaders out of them for folks like you in the long run. So that's going to be the topic. Feel free to ask questions at the end of it, and I'm going to make it more interactive as we go on. So let me get started. I'm going to start with a quiz question for you. I've been a quizzer for all my life, so I think that's going to continue here as well. Now, all the brands that you see in front of the screen, what's common to it? Don't tell me technology, don't tell me mobile, but what's common to all of this?
Young entrepreneur.
I'm sorry?
Apps?
No, not that. Also, technology, no, nothing. It's pretty evident, no? Young generation is okay.
Communication.
Communication, okay, I'll take that, but what?
Leaders.
Convenience, exactly, yes.
Leaders.
Leaders in the space, of course, there's a top 10 apps potentially on the Play Store, App Store. Sorry?
Go easy.
Go easy, fantastic.
Disruptive.
Disruptive, brilliantly put, fantastic.
Networking,
of course, yes, no denying it. So let's stop there, but I have a very interesting way to look at what's common to all of this. User experience, fantastic, that's also there, right? That's why they're all number one today. But I'll make you think very differently now when I tell you something now, right? This is what 2017 looks like, right? That's a commonality, right? Now let me tell you something else now. How did 2007 look like? Nothing existed. All these changes you're seeing in front of you right now, the apps, were not existing in this world 2007. Nothing long, but just 10 years, right? In 10 years, you have so much of a progress that happened that you would never imagine would be possible 10 years ahead of you, right? Now, can you imagine to live a life without those apps today? Of course not. Even if any one of you in this room decide to leave all of it and go have a great life out there without being in touch, I think still to do that, you would take an Uber. That's the irony, right? We can't live without this. But imagine if somebody graduating out of 2007 or 2005 or 2008 had these apps right from the time they got into the workforce. Do you think they can be treated the same way you would treat somebody graduated in 1995 or 2000? Of course not. That's the first step towards a modern employee. Let me add more dimensions to it now. Change has never happened this fast before, and this will never be this slow again. There's a very powerful statement if you start looking very deeper, right? We are talking about the fact that potentially banking could get disrupted in 100 years, and potentially the institution of marriage could take a shot in about 100 years as well. Because AI is going to take over. We are talking about a lot of things like that, right? So change is coming faster than we can imagine. Now, let me clarify the word modern employee even better, right? Going deeper into it. So when I was a kid, right? But today, it's very, very different across what channels. Now, for example, the news. I think I've always grown up looking at the Hindu in front of my home when I woke up in the morning. That's my only news source. But you know what's interesting aspect today? All of us in this room have access to news based on whom we follow or who are on LinkedIn list or who are friends on Facebook. Because that's where we consume news from. If your friends are smarter, your circle is smarter, then you get access to more innovative news. If they are not, you don't get it. So the way you consume news has completely changed. You agree with me on that?
Yes.
Fantastic. Food. Doesn't matter what it is. All that we have is Maggi 2-minute noodle back then, right? But today you had Zomato and Swiggy. You don't have to worry about anything. And that's why they're taking up funds from across the world for growing up, right? Food has become digital as well, and all of us agree, right? careers, more important topic as we speak, was campus interviews, what, Naukri, I think it was back then. But today you're talking about multiple aspects to get a job. LinkedIn has 500 million members and everybody can get a job easily, right? Technology again. Even better, let me go. Networking and relationship. I met my wife, current wife back then, my fiance, in my friend's wedding, right? But today, people in my own company find their own girlfriends and boyfriends on Tinder. Digital again. All of these have gone through a complete disruption because the only way of accessing all this is digital today, right? That's my point. Pick an activity that consumption digital. And I'll tell you what's interesting thing has happened. All of us have how many hours in a day today? 24. But how many of us multitask today? Pretty much all of us, right? We are all of us multitask, which means all of us don't have 24 hours. We actually have 31 hours of activity in a day. And that splits something like this. But the good news is they're spending almost 6 to 7 hours in terms of learning and office. So they're still spending a lot of time in work, right? Which is great news. All of these trends have today brought up something called the modern employee and consumerization of enterprise, as they call it as well. Too many jargons, I'm going to cut it down, but that's what it is, a modern employee. A person who's been growing up this way is not going to get into a leadership development, become leader the traditional way. It has to be reimagined. And that's where there's a point of view that I have that is going to be the way leaders have to be developed as we move forward. It's a point of view, happy to debate at the end of it, but let me share what is that in my head, right? Before that, there's something that we have put together as who I believe a modern employee is as three traits. And I very strongly believe this won't get any better. It's only going to get worse. And what is that? A modern employee is always distracted. I believe in data backing, so there's some numbers for you on that. A modern employee is always going to be impatient. And a modern employee is always going to be overwhelmed. Now, how many of you are telling me this is going to get better as we go on? It's going to be worse. There you go, gentlemen, is saying there, right? It's going to get worse. And this is your new reality. If news is going to be consumed in a digital way, if they're going to find the life partners a Tinder way, then your new modern employee is always and always going to be distracted, impatient, and overwhelmed. This is not going to get any better. So I very strongly believe that a traditional leadership development or a learning itself for that matter won't apply anymore. And what I believe is going to be potentially working out for all of us, or that's my point of view, is a three-pronged strategy, right? But before getting into that, I like to take the stakeholders and say what it means to them, and I put my own strategy here. Number one, there are three different stakeholders in any leadership development or learning, right? Business, the learner right at the center, and the folks like you, the fraternity, who's driving this change, right? So, how to develop leaders out of modern employees with differing needs and priorities across stakeholders? That's the fundamental thing. And I like to always start with business because that's dynamically changing and it's important that we keep them in loop in whatever we do. And some pointers, leadership is always going to ask for accelerated leadership pipeline. The key word here is accelerated. Leadership pipeline has always existed. You agree that your people are going to say, in 6 months, can you get somebody ready for this new geography? Have you heard of queries like that from your leaders? Yes? That's also going to get more and more, important for them, and it's not going to get any lower, right? Full alignment with business goals. Hey, what's your budget for learning? What's your budget leadership development? Here, take it. No. Every penny is going to be asked for an ROI, right? That's going to get more and more. And effective engagement. I don't want people to walk away out of my sessions. Let them learn and become better leaders. And the last, ensure scale and cost effectiveness. Today we live in a world where we want the best quality, best scale, but keep the cost low. And all this won't change, agree with me? So impatient, overwhelmed, distracted, your modern learner is not going to change. The needs of what the business wants is also not going to change. And let's see what the learner wants, right? The modern employee. High comfort, technology, and mobile. So give me something that's got that in my learning sessions as well. I don't want somebody talking to me, right? And he or she will value experience over instructions. They pretty much don't want what I'm doing right now. Don't come and stand for 8 hours and tell me what to do. I'm over it, right? That's not going to change. Now what is, when all this is going to be a definite ask and will not change, what it means to you? I put that over there as well. Pressure to meet business objectives, not going to change. Manage expectations from both sides, not going to change. Content and solution explosion. So this is an interesting thing, right? If you've seen orchestra, the music, right? A conductor doesn't really play anything, right? He just does this and everybody plays those tunes. To me, all of you are a conductor of an orchestra today. Why? Because content is available for free. People are willing to give it for free. The MOOCs, whatnot, right? Coursera and all of that. So which means you don't have to worry about content anymore. But how do you make the content relevant to your employees to make leaders out of them? That's what you need to worry about. That orchestration is going to be the key. And this is the most important point, data-driven evaluations. There's an interesting thing that I observed in modern employees, right? Confirmation bias. Interesting, how many of you use Quora here? Quora? Few of you, right? Tell me, why do you like Quora, actually? Why do you like Quora? Okay, let me go deeper into that. You're getting answer almost anything. Do you get the answer that you think you want to hear or a generic answers? Diverse perspective, right? But psychologically, there's an interesting paper, if I can share, I'll share it after the session with you, is the reason why Quora is very successful is because it reaffirms the confirmation bias humans have. That's the truth. It's very scary, but that's the truth. Because you go to Quora and say, I have these problems, there are a million other people that they're going to say they have the same problems too. Oh, great, I'm not the only one. Awesome, hey. Right? That's why you love Quora, you go spread Quora. That's a reality, by the way. That's the truth. If you now start thinking deeper, all your answers you go search for is what you want to see and what that's out there. On the other side is Twitter, where everything is open here and that's where you fight on it. People don't fight on Quora. People fight on Twitter because it's of opposite views out there, right? That's the biggest difference. The reason I'm saying that is because when you go to a modern learner or a millennial that he's going to speak about, when you say, you're not going to cut out to be a great leader, give me data. I'm not here to talk to you. Give me data. Give me proof. Why am I not? Why is he better? They're always going to keep asking you for it, which means data-driven decision-making becomes a key for you more than anybody else because you're dealing with people and not non-living objects. All right? Now, these are the truth, and are we on the same page until now? What's the reality in all of that with the learner and all of us put together? So here, this is the most important slide I'd like to focus. When you're doing any leadership development intervention, you should start with the end in mind. What you want to achieve. So the outcome that I'm willing to target over here is greater innovation, increased value, reduced cost, sustainable growth. And the benchmark is, if you're able to hit 2 out of 4 or 50%, we have done our jobs. Nobody can question us. We've done the right thing for everybody and we've got the leaders in the pipeline in the accelerated fashion. Now, to get the outcomes, what should be the inputs across stakeholder wise? So for the business, I'm not sure about your organizations, but you can tell me if I'm right or wrong. Most leadership development interventions happen in silo with respect to what business wants. When I say that, you don't let the potential future leaders learn about business, but you directly put them into, hey, manage people, manage change, and so on and so forth. Does this happen often? Yeah, right? So we're getting confirmation, but I like it now. Right? So you keep getting the, over here that you don't have to learn about business, but let's go into people development. But here we say we'll start with business. An interesting trivia here, the founder of Intel, Gordon Moore, right? He said back then, 50, 60 years back, that every 18 months, right, the speed, the computation speed would double and the size of the chip will be reduced by half. We all know that, right? So that is an interesting thing called Moore's Law for Business. Now what is that? Every 18 months, you have to fundamentally relook at your business models because you might not exist after some time. So every 18 months, you have to start relooking at the business. Why? Because change has never been this fast, it'll never be this slow again, right? So I'll tell you how we achieve it in the upcoming slides. And learner at the center, now learner doesn't want what? Instructions and wants data, right? So we should offer them safe learning environments, like how we offer for pilots and doctors, and ask them to take decisions in a gray area called leadership development or behavioral learning. And if you can do that, then they make mistakes and they learn. That's the second approach. And the third one would be is culture, the word orchestrate again. Orchestrate the organization through leadership and culture. right? If these three goes into an input, then I think we can achieve the outcome of what I spoke to you, that is greater innovation, increased value, reduced cost, and sustainable growth. Now, have organizations adopted this, or is it like futuristic? I'd like to take the next four slides with some real case studies of clients who's worked in India for us with the same methodology. So I'm going to choose one client for each of these pillars. I'm going to share some examples with you. For the first one, understanding aligning style and business model. So this is something that we will ask our learners to do before they start. So you will have to start filling this canvas. I'm not getting deeper into the canvas, but when you can enter what your business is all about inside this 8 boxes, you can go deeper into know what you do. Again, back to quiz. What business do you think Apple is in? So you know, by now you would have known my style. It's not easy to answer this. That's why I'm asking this. So tell me, what do you think Apple is in? Which business in Apple is in?
ICT.
ICT? Okay, that's what they bucket themselves as. Fantastic, but what else? Think deeper.
Innovation.
Fantastic innovation. But what do they mean?
Human experience.
Fantastic, user experience, right? But if you go deeper into see what Apple's value proposition is, that's a right at the center, you know what business they are in? Apple wants to be the social currency of people in the world. Meaning, doesn't matter what Apple throws at you, you should be okay to flaunt it. Hey, that's me. Apple iPods. And that's why Apple is moving away from computers to phones to watches and to cars tomorrow. What's it even got to do with technology then? But they're doing it, why? Because people are going to flaunt it. And that's why you pay a 10x premium for it. Otherwise, you wouldn't do it. So if you are a business of social currency, what can you innovate with? You see this kind of direction? It changes the entire mindset. Now, can your potential leaders think like this for your business? We help you with that. And that's the starting point should be. Now, once they understand the big picture, we need to give them a, what do you call, an environment where they can apply what they think is their own strategy for making the business better and see if they're going to succeed or fail. And for that, what we can do is actually create or mirror the entire business of an organization into a safe learning environment. And we tell them, build your business. And the example that you see over there is we've done it for Kotak earlier. We replicated the entire insurance business of Kotak onto a safe learning environment. And with this, you collect a lot of data and see how people make decisions. Now that's a step one of what I spoke to you about in terms of the three-pronged approach. And second is about safe learning environment. Once we establish this in the leadership development journey, then we go to what we already like. Change management, managing people, managing performance and all of that, but not through the traditional, hear me, I will preach. I will podcast, you listen. No. You drive it, you make mistakes, you learn, and let's go the journey together. So what we do for that is create safe learning environments like this, right? So a lot of companies around you, like Accenture, a lot of manufacturing companies actually use this as well to make their people learn. Some more, so each topic is a different scenario. So they've got different products to actually get that through. That's exactly, so this is a very interesting theme all of us talk about, right? Unconscious incompetence to unconscious competence. At each level, you can actually verify whether it's working or not. You need data and analytics, right? That won't come with a very traditional session, you don't have data. But with a simulation or a data or a technology-based intervention, you can get data towards these four approaches. And analytics and reports could look pretty much like this. This is not a problem with my slides, you pick up. Yeah. A lot of data like this can actually help prove a point and gives you a return on investment for what you've invested in across levels. And the last one, I've not touched upon the culture, and that's going to be my closing sentence here, is something that, this is something of a model that you have developed for some of the organizations, but I can quote them in a public forum, so I'm going to do that. When you say modern employee, the first roadblock that comes in is, hey, my company is traditional. My company is in the manufacturing. I'm doing this. I don't think this will work for us. It's wrong. So we have worked on something like this, which is an end-to-end detailed journey about last week with Wellspun. So Wellspun is leader in what they do, right? We all know it. Wimbledon towels are done by Wellspun. And they have been in the world for so long, but guess what? They know that their own employees are modern today. The company might have tradition. But they, as an organization, are modern employees, which means they know that old traditions won't work. And that's how they've adopted this. And the last thing is another public sector bank in India, right? We all think public sector banks are old school, right? A top three public sector bank in this country has actually taken this approach towards leadership development. I'm telling this because in my own journey over the last close to 5 years at KNOLSKAPE, I've seen people take decisions. This has been very different in the way they've taken the approach towards their leadership development. I just thought I'd share that with you so that it helps you think as well in depth. I love this man, so I'm going to quote him before I leave. So Satya Nadella, the man who increased $250 billion after taking over. This is a very important thing that he talks about, the framework that I showed you, and how the future could look like if you're using new technology, new innovation in terms of your own leadership development. And that is this. Let me read it. You need new concepts with new innovation, and you have to have new capability and culture to go after those new concepts. Your existing success kind of fights those things. So you have to over-amplify the new concept and the culture required for it, and that's the journey. And that is what I think most of us are going to embark on as the days to come. Thank you, everyone. I hope this was useful for every one of you.
Any questions?
No? Okay. I was either too clear or too not too clear, sir. Too clear? Thanks. Confirmation bias.